Hello everyone, we'll continue the discussion of fluid kinematics. This is part 2 or the session number, lecture number 2, right? We have done earlier many things. We'll just revise the final definition and then go ahead straight away. This, I think, uniform flow and non-uniform flow I have defined. The flow characteristics do not change with respect to time. All this has been discussed. So phi represents any fluid flow characteristics. If it is not changing from one point to the other point in the fluid flow, then we say that it is a uniform flow. And for non-uniform flow, I had written this as dou phi, that is a differentiation or change with respect to space. The change of fluid characteristics with respect to space is not equal to zero, indicating that there is a change, right? Then it is a non-uniform flow. This is already told. We'll go further. Okay. Here one more type of classification of the flow, here in one dimensional, two dimensional and three dimensional. Can just see here, one dimensional flow, the flow characteristics change only in one direction, they remain constant in other directions. That is, phi is, or velocity is, function of x and t as far as unsteady flow is concerned, means the changes with respect to time also and with respect to one direction also. That's why it is unsteady. Suppose there is no change with respect to time, then V is function of x only in one direction, then it is steady flow in one direction. Look at this, the velocity is dependent on time, yes, means with respect to time it is changing, then it is unsteady. Moreover, it is dependent on only one direction. That's why it is a unidirectional or one-dimensional flow, right? It is independent of time, means as the time passes, the velocity is not changing, but the time, velocity is changing with respect to space. The example for this would be, I'll be discussing later stage, right? That will be a separate lecture I'll be taking for that. Space-wise, there is no variation. With respect to time, there is no variation. There are two different things, right? So V is only function of x, but it is not time dependent. If I quote here itself, one small example, suppose there is a flow here, and then let us say there is a point A here, the point B here, and the velocity at this point, right? Now let us say it is 5 meter per second. Okay, velocity at point B is, let us say, 7 meter per second. Okay, now space wise there is a variation, means if I take point A and point B, there is a change. But if I say I have taken this particular data as 12 o'clock, now if I observe after 5 minutes, 12:05, the velocity is not changing, whether you take here or there. Now 12 o'clock, it was 7 meter per second, 12:05, it is 7 meter per second, right? Now here if you come to 12:15 and try to see, let us say it is 5 meter per second only, means at this particular point the velocity is not changing with respect to time, it is a steady flow. At this particular point, the point B, it was 7 meter per second, it has been 7 meter per second, it is not changing with respect to time. But if you compare point A and point B, there is a change. So that is to say, in particular direction there is a change, but with respect to time there is no change. Such a flow is a steady flow. I think this example would be a very important example, right? With respect to time also, if it is changing, then it is an unsteady flow, right? So point A, point B, there are two points, the two different velocities. Space wise they are different, but with respect to time at the same point, if you observe, the variation is not there. That's why it is steady flow. Anyway, this variation we are considering in only one direction, that's why it is one dimensional flow. The best or simple example would be a pipe flow, right? Because in pipe what happens is it will be a very long flow, right? So if I try to draw a small sketch of that pipe flow, and if I consider a section, the velocity over here, we assume that the velocity at different points here, there, it is all uniform. But if I consider the velocity at this point and then other points, if the diameter is changing or something else is happening, then the velocity may be changing or the flow characteristics may be changing. So when the flow characteristics are not changing in other two directions, only one direction is there to study the change, then it is one dimensional flow, right? Now if the flow characteristic change in two dimensions, right, it will be 2D flow. If the flow characteristic change in three dimensional, then it is a 3D flow. Obviously V is a function of x, y and t for unsteady flow. Otherwise V is equal to f of x, y only for steady flow. The example can be the same old one. And 3D flow, it is dependent on all the three directions as well as time, then it is unsteady. If it is independent of time, then it will be steady. For two dimensional flow, suppose there is a channel flow and the channel is changing its dimension. Suppose if it is changing, now the flow is occurring this way, the width of the flow is small, now width of the flow is more, and then if I am considering velocity or pressure or something else, then the velocity at this particular point will be different. And then here when it is occurring or coming from a small section of the channel, then it will be faster. So once the width becomes larger, the velocity changes. So these changes will occur this way, right, or this way as well as this way, then it is two-dimensional flow, right? So here in this direction also there is a change, but in this direction also there is a change, right? Now if I try to draw a velocity diagram, now it may be something like this. At this point the velocities are different, fine, right, but they are not changing. But here if it will be like this, so it is a 2D flow, right? Two dimensions in which the variation is occurring, right? Okay, so 1D, 2D and 3 dimensional flows. Next is laminar and turbulent flow. There is one more classification, laminar and turbulent flows. When the flow occurs like sheets or laminates and the fluid elements flowing in a layer does not mix with other layer, then the flow is said to be laminar. In the sense, it is a sheet like flow, as if number of sheets are flowing, right? If the base of the channel is here, it will be flowing very nicely, systematically. The flow will not be mixing. So this flow is going in its own way, this flow is going in its own way, like that, very systematic flow it is, no intermixing. Obviously the velocity in this flow will be slightly less. Now how to recognize that it is a laminar flow? Here we take use of Reynolds number. What is Reynolds number? It is an expression, Re will be calculated in pipe. If you want to calculate, it is phi d rho by mu. Now this hasn't got any dimensions. Velocity has got dimensions, meter per second. Units will be meter per second. Diameter will be having a units of meters. The density will be having units of kg per meter cube. The mu, the dynamic viscosity, will be having Pascal second as the units. Now if you calculate the units for all this combination, it is a unitless combination. So that's why it is dimensionless quantity. So it is a unitless or dimensionless number. Now this number is used to recognize whether it is a laminar flow or turbulent flow. When the Reynolds number RE for the flow is less than 2000, then we say that the fluid flow is laminar. Of course, this is a pipe flow they are talking about. So when the number, when this quantity is less than 2000, then it will be a laminar flow. Next is, when the flow velocity increases, means as I have told you, laminar flow will be occurring at lower velocities, sheet like flow will be there. Now if the velocity is increased, the sheet like flow gets mixed with other layers and the flow of fluid elements become random, causing turbulence. So now what happens is, in the second case, it is just layer wise it was moving, but the velocity is increased, because of that it gets mixed, right? Now up bottom layer may come up or go there, or even at some times a reversal of flow will be happening. Maybe here also it will be like that because of the push that is happening. So this kind of haphazard flow, you can say, right, causing turbulence. This disturbance is known as turbulence. There will be eddy currents generated of the flow reversal takes place. So this reversal of the flow is called eddies. This flow is said to be turbulent flow. So this particular flow is a turbulent flow. And then if it is perfectly sheet like flow, then it will be a laminar flow. Okay. Now when the Reynolds number for the flow will be greater than 4000, now if you take Vd rho by mu, the fluid will be carrying the same, let us say, same diameter, same density, same viscosity, and if the velocity is increased, the value increases and there is a chance that it may reach more than 4000. In such case, definitely, when the Reynolds number is more than 4000, definitely the flow is turbulent. The flow with Reynolds number between 2000 and 4000, it is said to be in transition or transition flow. Here you cannot decide whether it is a laminar flow or turbulent flow. Sometimes it behaves like that, sometimes it behaves like this. So because of that, you will not be exactly say that it is laminar or turbulent. That's why in between 2000 and 4000, it will be a transition flow. Okay, there is a rotational flow and then irrotational flow also. Now what is rotational flow? Now if the fluid particles rotate about its mass center while moving in the direction of the flow, it is known as rotational flow. They will be rotating as well as they will be moving. Obviously, it will be rotational flow. Example, fluid in a rotating tank or a tornado or swirl, right? So you might have seen these swirls, etc., tornado, where the air will be getting rotated in a cylindrical fashion with changing diameter, right? All those things are rotational flows. Of course, there will be a motion, but there will be a rotation also. Irrotational flow, if the fluid particles do not rotate about their mass centers while moving in the direction of the flow is known as irrotational flow. Such flow exists in ideal fluids. Irrotational flow is also called potential flow, right? Slide. So the same rotational flow is represented by an element. Here I have written clearly, consider fluid element ABCD. ABCD, that is the fluid element. In time dt, let it undergo some deformation. And then what is the deformation that has happened? AD, which was vertical side, now it has become AD dashed, or it has rotated through an angle gamma 2, let us say. And then the side AB has become AB dashed, let us say, and then it has rotated in an anti-clockwise manner. That way the fluid element obviously will be looking different, because it was like this, the C will not be there, because this has become D dashed, this has become B dashed. Obviously the fluid element will be looking like that, with C gone to C dashed. The same element has enlarged in this manner. The sides have got rotated slightly here, slightly there. The first AD has rotated in clockwise, AB has rotated in anti-clockwise manner. Now if I try to put the calculations, now this is x direction. So we have x direction as this, the velocity here it is u, and here it has become u plus dou u by dou y into dy, the changes with respect to space or with respect to direction. You can see that it is original u is u, this is rate of change with respect to space, and then multiplied by the distance. So that's how it has changed. Here also in x direction, if I go u, I have not shown u here, I have shown u has become u plus dou u by dou y into dy, or v, the v has become v plus dou v by dou x into dx. Okay, now here it is dou u, here it is dou v in a time of dou t. Now dou u, gamma and dy I can interrelate. How? Tan gamma 2 I have written for gamma 1, let us say tan gamma 1 is equal to dou v by dou x, because it is a right angle triangle. Tan gamma 1 will be dou v by dou x, because the extent of rotation or the angle is too small, we can say that gamma 1 is equal to dou v by dou x, and it is anti-clockwise. Okay, it has rotated that way. And gamma 2 is dou u by dou y, dou u by dou y, opposite side of adjacent side. Okay, now with anti-clockwise as positive, means gamma 1 is positive whereas gamma 2 is negative, the average rotation would be equal to gamma 1 minus, that is gamma 2 plus gamma 2 divided by 2, average. Right, gamma 1 plus gamma 2 divided by 2, that is the average rotation. Now the same thing, I try to put it in the form of picture. You can just see that brown is xy plane ABCD, with A there, B there, C, D. Then there is a Z axis. Now when it rotates, it is happening like that. You can just see here, this is the original element. Now that edge is rotated, AB edge is rotated in anti-clockwise manner, AD edge is rotated in clockwise manner. Okay, that is clockwise rotation, that is anti-clockwise rotation. Okay, now here rotation about Z axis or Z axis, one is this, one is that. Now this is given by, rotation is denoted by, once again by omega, but with a suffix. Omega z indicates it is a rotation about z axis, is equal to, here there is a half, that is average, divide, I mean multiplied by Now what is gamma 1? Gamma 1 is dou v by dou x, and then gamma 2 is minus, it is dou u by dou y, minus because it is clockwise, right? So like this we can calculate a rotation about z axis. On the same lines, rotation about x axis, if we want to calculate, it will be half dou w by dou y minus dou v by dou z, and rotation about y axis. Now let us say how to write. I'll tell you a technique how to write this. Suppose if I want to write a rotational component in y direction, how should I write? It is equal to average, that's why this half is there outside, and you put a bracket, put a bracket, there is a ratio here, and there is a minus sign in between, there is a ratio here also. We have written y here, we want rotation about y axis. You write here the next cyclic letter z as dou z, and then next is dou x, okay? Because we want the rotation in y direction, I'll write omega y is equal to half into bracket, in the denominator we have dou z dou x. Now with respect to dou x, I have dou u here, and then with respect to dou z, I have dou w there, right? The velocity in z direction, velocity in x direction. That's how the expression is written. You can just check it here. Omega y is equal to half dou u by dou z or dou z minus dou w by dou x. It is a partial differentiation of u with respect to z direction, partial differentiation of velocity in z direction with respect to x. Now final statement, if all these components, these are called rotational components, all these components are equal to zero, every one of them, then it is a rotational flow. If any one or all of omega x, omega y, omega z are not equal to, any one or all of them are not equal to zero, then it is a rotational flow. Now there is a vorticity, or rotation is calculated at 2 times omega z. Obviously 2 times omega z will be equal to dou v by dou x minus dou u by dou z. So this is called z with a suffix. Z means vorticity in z direction. This is also pronounced as z only, zz you can call it as. So that is about rotational motion. In this session I'm going to discuss about velocity and acceleration components of the flow. We'll see how further. Velocity already we have discussed, but acceleration is a new thing for you. Yeah, this figure already you know, position is represented by xi, yz, zk. X is here, y is there in y direction, z is in z direction. So that is the position vector. Position is changed from p to q, right, in a time of dt, and ds by dt is a velocity, velocity components are dx by dt, dy by dt, dz by dt. The total change in position is displacement ds, is dxi, dyz, dz, k. This already you know now. Okay. So motion in x direction, y direction, z direction. This leads to this motion you have seen, p to q. The same thing is broken into components. Okay. Now velocity component in x direction is u dx by dt, and v dy by dt in z direction, or in z direction it is omega dz by dt. Vector form of velocity, v is equal to ui plus vj plus omega k. Magnitude of the velocity, if you want, it will be square root of u squared plus v squared plus omega squared. Now here u is function of x, y, z and t, v is x, y, z and t, omega is also x, y, z and t depending upon whether it is three-dimensional or one-dimensional flow. But in general, it is a function of space as well as time. That's what you can remember. Now, here, when the velocity changes, right, the velocity which is dx by dt is changed, then the rate of change of velocity itself is known as acceleration. So how do we define acceleration? Acceleration of a fluid element along any one direction, any direction, can be defined as the rate of change of velocity of the fluid along the direction with respect to time. So it is not I am telling you dv by dt directly, but in each direction what is the change with respect to time. So the change of velocity u with respect to time is known as acceleration ax. So it is acceleration is in any one direction, any direction can be defined as rate of change of velocity of the fluid element along the direction, along the direction with respect to time, acceleration of fluid element. Right, now if I say if ax, ay and az are the components of acceleration along x, y, z directions respectively, then they can be mathematically written as ax is equal to du by dt, differentiation or change of u with respect to time. Du by dt is the change in u with respect to time, change in u as the time changes. That is ax. But u itself is function of x, y and t. It is not a variable which is dependent on 1, 2, 3, 4 variables. So by using chain rule, one can write the same ax as du by dt is equal to, look at this, du by dt plus du by dx into dx by dt, du by dy into dy by dt plus du by dz and dz by dt. So that's how the acceleration is written as, right? So this rate of change is only with respect to time. This rate of change is with respect to space and then again with respect to time in that direction. Like that it continues by chain rule. So because there are four dependent variables, there are four factors here. Now, this is written as for ax. Now how to remember this big equation? It is simple. Ax is du by dt straight away 1 plus there are three terms, and then you can just see here this is u, this is u, this is u. So differentiation of u with respect to x, u with respect to y, u with respect to z, and then this dx by dt, this dy by dt, this dz or dz by dt. That's how to write. So if you practice a couple of times, I think it will be easy for you to recall how to write expression for acceleration in a particular direction ax equal to. On the same lines, you can write ay also. So dv by dt is there, this is purely differentiation with respect to time, plus again here there is v, here there is v, here there is v, differentiation in x direction, in y direction, in z direction, and again multiplied by dx by dt, dy by dt. Similarly, az equal to dw by dt, dw, 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 dx, dy, dz, dx by dt, dy by dt, dz by dt. So this is component, component, component. Now whole acceleration or total acceleration can be written as ax in I direction because it is in x direction, plus ayz to tell that it is in y direction, is zk to tell that it is in z direction. So if you want magnitude of acceleration, then magnitude or modulus a is equal to square root of ax squared plus ay squared plus az squared. That's how you can calculate magnitude of acceleration. this is total acceleration, these are components of acceleration, and then u, v, w are velocity components in x, y and z directions. Okay, thank you. We'll stop here.